Hi, this is Philip Padour, founder of NTLEX RN 45 Day Challenge. In this video, I'm going to be talking about pyloric stenosis. Our learning objectives today will be to define pyloric stenosis, discuss clinical presentations, outline diagnostic criteria, and also review the management of these conditions. So to start, what is pyloric stenosis? Pyloric stenosis is a hypertrophy of the pyloric muscles with elongations, thickening, and near-complete obstructions of the gastric outlet. It was first described as early as 1717 in Europe, and by 1887, the pathology was understood. This is the most common cause of metabolic alkalosis in infancy. You can see on the diagram that there is an area where we can see the hypertrophy of the muscles where the pyloric stenosis obstructs the gastric outlet. Importantly, epidemiology for this diagnosis, it occurs 2 to 3.5 patients per 1,000 live births in the United States. It is 5 times more common in male than in females. Generally presents in children between 3 to 5 weeks of age. 30% of the patients are the first-born children in their families, and the familiar aggregations is common with there being a 20-fold higher incidence among the siblings. There have been several genetic loci that predispose patients to pyloric stenosis that have been identified. For example, the infant hypertrophic pyloric stenosis 1 or HPS1 gene or NOS1 encodes for a gene that affects the neuronal nitric acids synthesis that affects the relaxations of smooth muscles and may contribute to progressions toward the pyloric stenosis. In addition, abnormalities in peptide-containing nerve fibers may also play a role. There are also environmental exposures that can predispose patients to having these conditions, one of which is macrolide antibiotics. It's been found that oral erythromycin for post-exposures for prophylaxis or for pertussis treatment has been implicated in the infantile hypertrophic pyloric stenosis cases. The clinical presentations is important to remember when evaluating a child for whom this may be a diagnosis. The patients are thin, dehydrated of these conditions, has gone on along for enough, and they can have a palpable olive in their abdomen. The olive is felt best immediately after emesis, as the stomach is more decompressed at that time. And this exam feature is almost always pathognomonic for this condition. Diagnosis can be made in a variety of ways. Labs are often drawn to examine the degree of the electrolyte imbalance and abnormalities in the patient. Electrolyte imbalances are from the loss of large amounts of gastric hydrochloric acid and retentions of bicarbonate leading to hyperchloremic metabolic acidosis. Again, the loss of HCl and KCl is from the vomiting, and there is a decrease in release of pancreatic bicarbonate because of the gastric outlet obstructions. This dehydration will lead to a contraction alkalosis as well. These electrolyte abnormalities, however, are now seen less commonly given to that diagnosis is being made earlier in the disease process. In addition, as was mentioned previously, as a palpable olive on the physical exam is also part of our diagnosis. In addition, ultrasound is almost always diagnostic, and an upper GI contrast study can also be performed. Here, we see an example of an ultrasound image showing the thickening of the pyloric muscles of the pyloric stenosis. Accuracy of the ultrasound is operator dependent, and we generally measure the pyloric muscle thickness, or the PI pyloric diameter, and the pyloric muscle length. In general, a pyloric muscle thickness of greater than 4 mm and length of greater than 16 mm and specificity of 89 to 100% respectively. Another study that can be performed as an upper GI of a patient with pyloric stenosis, you can see the apple core or string sign swing toward this image. Another study that can be performed as an upper GI or a patient with pyloric stenosis, as you can see, the apple core or string sign toward the right of this image. We see an elongated pyloric canal given that the muscles are making this canal smaller than they normally would be on an upper gastrointestinal studies. Treatment for this condition is exclusively surgical. Pyloromyotomy have been performed regularly for these conditions. Surgery should be delayed, however, until the patient's stable and adequately hydrated with the return to normalcy of their electrolytes. The procedure involves longitudinal incisions of the pyloric hypertrophic pylorus and the dissections to the level of the submucosa. You can see in this image that this allows the lumen of the pylorus to be open and no longer compressed by the thickened muscles. Another possible intervention is the balloon dilations, but this is not an effective disruption of the seromuscular ring which is causing the obstructions. In summary, pyloric stenosis is caused by hypertrophy of the pyloric muscles presenting symptoms including consistent postprandial emesis and subsequent hunger. Treatment consists of electrolyte stabilizations and surgical repair.